Good afternoon. Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus? The first item of business is a statement by Nicola Sturgeon on COVID-19 update. The First Minister will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Nicola Sturgeon, First Minister.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. I will set out the Cabinet's decision on the timescale for converting the legal requirement to wear face coverings in certain indoor settings into guidance. Firstly, though, and to set the context for that decision, I'll give a brief update on the current COVID situation. The most recent ONS COVID infection survey for the week ending 20th March indicated that 1 in 11 people in Scotland had COVID. That is the highest level of infection so far recorded by this weekly survey, and it does reflect the impact of the highly infectious BA2 subvariant of the virus. The daily case numbers also show a very high, though perhaps stabilising, level of infection. Today, 9,610 new cases identified through a PCR or a lateral flow test will be reported. Again, though, it's important to set these figures in some context. 2 weeks ago, there were, on average, just over 12,400 new cases being reported each day. 1 week ago, the average case number was still high at around 12,000 a day. But over the past week, it has fallen to 10,200 a day, which is a 15% reduction in the past 7 days. And the reduction is fairly consistent across all age groups. So that does give us grounds for optimism that this latest wave of infection may now have peaked. Of course, the daily numbers on their own need to be treated with a degree of caution. But the result of wastewater sampling, which is an important strand of our ongoing surveillance, also gives some cause for optimism. It's not yet indicating a fall in the level of infection, but it does suggest that the situation has stabilised since mid-March. We'll therefore continue to assess the data closely, including, of course, the results of the latest ONS survey, which are due later this week. But we are hopeful that this wave has peaked or is now peaking. Indeed, this is being observed already in Northern Ireland, which, unlike England and Wales, appears to have been ahead of Scotland in the transmission of BA2. Although the BA2 variant is highly infectious, indeed more so than the original Omicron variant, it is important to stress that vaccination continues to provide strong protection against serious illness, which of course underlines the importance of getting all doses of vaccines that we are offered. The programme of additional boosters for certain groups started 3 weeks ago in older people's care homes, and from last week, appointments are being offered to everyone aged 75 and over. People with suppressed immune systems will have appointments for additional boosters scheduled during spring and summer, starting from the 18th of April, and appointment letters will be issued by post. Anyone who is unsure about eligibility for an additional booster should, of course, contact their doctor for advice. In addition, the vaccination programme for 5 to 11-year-olds is underway. Children in that age group with specific medical conditions and those who are household contacts of someone who is immunosuppressed were already being vaccinated in line with JCVI advice. Vaccination of the wider 5 to 11-year-old age group started on the 19th of March, and that will continue over coming weeks. Older children are being given appointments first, but families are being invited to get vaccinated together whenever that is possible. Obviously, with case rates being as high as they've been recently, some young people who are invited for a vaccine will recently have had COVID, so I want to briefly summarise the guidelines for those circumstances. Those aged 5 to 17 who have specific medical conditions or who are household contacts of someone who is immunosuppressed should wait 4 weeks after first testing positive or from the onset of symptoms before being vaccinated, and 4 weeks is also the recommended gap for adults who get the virus. All others aged 5 to 17 should wait 12 weeks after having the virus before being vaccinated. Parents or carers of children who have been unable to be vaccinated due to having COVID should call the helpline on 0800 030 8013 to reschedule appointments when that is necessary. The advice to everyone, of course, remains as important as ever. Please do take the opportunity to get vaccinated as soon as you are able and make sure you get all doses of the vaccine that you are eligible for. This remains the most important thing any of us can do to protect ourselves and others, and of course it is never too late to get vaccinated. Despite the effectiveness of vaccination, the high level of infection has put the National Health Service under even more severe strain in recent weeks. We are seeing the impact of that in all parts of the NHS, not least in our accident and emergency services. The number of people in hospital with COVID reported today, 2,344, is, I'm pleased to say, 39 fewer than the number yesterday. But yesterday's figure was the highest it had been since the start of the pandemic. So today's number is still exceptionally high, and it is significantly above the previous peak of hospital cases, which was 2,053 back in January 2021. More positively, and again, this is evidence of the power of vaccination, the number of patients in intensive care with COVID remains relatively low, at 26 on today's figures, which is a fall of 15 in the past 2 weeks. Nevertheless, the volume of people in hospital with COVID is causing very significant pressure for a health service that has been dealing with the pandemic for more than 2 years now. That means we cannot be complacent and shouldn't be complacent. For the period up until Easter, therefore, we are continuing to ask everyone to take a lateral flow test twice a week, to take a test daily for 7 days if you are a close contact of someone who has tested positive, and to take a test before visiting someone who is vulnerable. If you have symptoms, you should continue to get a PCR test either at a testing site or by post. And if you test positive, you should isolate and follow the advice from Test and Protect. Using the approach set out a few weeks ago in the revised strategic framework and based on the government's clinical advice, our assessment is that the virus at this stage continues to present a medium threat. However, we do remain optimistic that it will move to being a low threat during the course of the spring. We have, of course, already largely moved away from reliance on legally imposed protective measures and are now relying instead on vaccines, treatments and sensible public health behaviours and adaptations. Indeed, 9 days ago, we lifted all bar one of the remaining COVID legal requirements. However, we did at that point retain in law the requirement to wear face coverings on public transport and in certain indoor settings. I said 2 weeks ago that we would review this requirement before the Easter recess, which we have now done. We have taken account of the very high level of infection and the pressure on the NHS, and also the fact that face coverings do provide an important layer of protection against transmission of the virus from one person to another. However, we are also mindful that the data may now be indicating a peaking of this wave of infection, which should hopefully become more pronounced over the next couple of weeks. We have therefore concluded, subject as always to the state of the pandemic, that the legal requirement to wear face coverings will be replaced with guidance on the following phased basis. From next Monday, 4th April, it will no longer be a legal requirement to wear a face covering in places of worship or while attending a marriage ceremony, a civil partnership registration or a funeral service or commemorative event. And then the wider legal requirements applying to shops, certain other indoor settings and public transport will be converted to guidance 2 weeks later on the 18th of April. We will, of course, continue to encourage the wearing of face coverings in certain indoor places, especially where significant numbers of people are present. This phased approach strikes, I think, a sensible balance between our desire to remove this one remaining legal measure and the common sense need for continued caution, not least for the sake of the NHS, while this wave of infection does subside. I recognise that face coverings are an inconvenience. However, given all the sacrifice of the past 2 years and in view of the current pressure on the NHS, I believe the vast majority of people will accept that for a further 2 weeks, this is a proportionate precautionary measure while we pass the peak of this latest wave. It also, of course, provides some additional protection to those who are most at risk from the virus. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, I want to take this opportunity again today to thank the public for the patience and the responsibility that continues to be demonstrated by the overwhelming majority of people across the country. Life has returned to normal for most of us, but COVID hasn't gone away. Indeed, there will be very few of us in recent weeks who have been untouched by this virus, either ourselves or within our families or networks of colleagues. That in itself is a sign of how infectious the virus continues to be. So while the level of infection remains as high as it is, I would ask people to continue, please, to take sensible basic steps in order to protect yourselves and others.
Thank you. The First Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we'll move on to the next item of business. I'd be grateful if members who wish to ask a question were to press the request to speak buttons now. And I call on Douglas Ross.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. This week, the number of people in Scotland waiting 4 hours at accident and emergency reached the worst level since records began. More people are waiting longer for cancer treatment than at any point since 2008. People with critical conditions and others with potentially terminal illnesses are not getting the treatment they need and deserve quickly enough. The pandemic has made things worse, but the First Minister cannot get away with just blaming COVID. So can she set out the specific actions that her government will take now to address these failings and ensure people in Scotland get the treatment they need when they need it? Turning to COVID, case rates here are now far higher than anywhere in the United Kingdom. The First Minister's strategy is clearly failing. And because of her failing strategy, she's keeping restrictions in place here in Scotland weeks after they've been removed elsewhere. Countries across the UK and Europe have already removed restrictions and are living with COVID. But today, the First Minister has signalled that face masks will continue for several more weeks. Now, we believe that anyone who wants to keep wearing a face mask should keep doing so, particularly if that will help vulnerable friends and relatives. But it should be down to individual choice, as it is in other parts of the United Kingdom. We should leave it up to people and businesses to decide what's best for them based on public health advice. Nicola Sturgeon has to start trusting the people of Scotland. Yeah, yeah. This just isn't an inconvenience. It's really holding some people back. Retaining face masks in schools and businesses is damaging for young people's education and limiting Scotland's economy. So can I ask the First Minister? Her statement didn't mention schools. When face masks are lifted on the 18th of April, will that include removing them entirely from schools, not just classrooms? And now that we've heard the third date that face masks will no longer be mandated in law, the First Minister has previously said the legal restriction would be lifted on the 21st of March, then early April, and now the 18th of April, will the First Minister guarantee that there will be no further delays?
First Minister.
It seems to me, and it always has done, completely inconsistent to rightly and understandably express concern about the pressure on our National Health Service and express concern about the high levels of infection on the one hand, but on the other hand bemoan the very limited protective measures that are still in place to help guide us through this. In terms of the pressure on the National Health Service, it is very significant right now in all parts of the National Health Service, but particularly in our accident and emergency departments. We have set out in recent weeks the range of different steps backed by significant investment that we are taking to support the National Health Service through the pandemic, but also into recovery. That is about investment. It's about continuing to increase the number of staff working in our National Health Service, but it's also about reforming the way care is delivered so that people get timely access to care in the places that they need it. But the most immediate and the most important thing we need to do to relieve pressure on our National Health Service is to get COVID cases down. We think that is now happening, and that is why I've set out the statement that I have done today. It's not the case to say that legal measures are not in place in any other part of the UK. I was speaking to the First Minister of Wales just yesterday, who have different legal protections in place than we have, but still have some legal protections in place. And it is important that we take a cautious approach through this. I think most people, and I do think that the evidence, all of the evidence that I have seen on public opinion, would suggest that Douglas Ross is just seriously out of step with the vast majority of people on this People understand that face coverings, particularly in public places where people don't always have a choice about being, people have to go to shops, and therefore if we all wear face coverings in shops right now, we help to protect each other. For a couple of weeks more, while we see this wave of infection peak and start to fall, I think that is a sensible thing to do. And I think the vast majority of people agree with that. And while nobody wants to be doing that for longer than necessary, I think most people accept that it is a sensible precautionary measure to take. And lastly, on schools, we would expect the requirements in schools, the remaining requirements in schools, to lift in line with the requirement for the general population.
Jackie Bailey.
Can I thank the First Minister for an advance copy of her statement? The levels of COVID do remain concerning, not least due to the impact on the NHS. And whilst life is returning to near normality for many, that is not the case for those who are immunocompromised and the 180,000 people who were on the shielding list. So where is the detail about testing for them and their family carers beyond April? And what about access to antivirals? When will the First Minister set out plans to ensure that they and their carers are afforded assurance about what will happen to them in the future? And whilst on the subject of testing, can the First Minister advise whether testing in schools will end? I understand that the advice being considered will be for pupils to stay off if they have any symptoms without knowing whether it's a cold or COVID. Pupils and staff absence is already high, and this will cause disruption to their education at a time when the exams are starting. Given that very little has been done to improve ventilation in classrooms, will the First Minister reconsider and make sure that asymptomatic testing continues in schools for at least the next 2 months? Finally, Presiding Officer, I welcome the next stage of the vaccination programme, but we really should have learnt the lessons from before and not be sending my 80-year-old constituents from Helensburgh to Dunoon a 100-mile round trip on two ferries to get their booster. Hundreds of people have been sent these letters, giving them appointments many, many miles away from home, and told that even if they were to get an appointment locally, they may need to wait until the end of May, beginning of June. This is a problem with the National Vaccination Scheduling Service. Can the First Minister ensure that it's fixed?
First Minister.
On the issue with vaccination in Argyll and Bute, we have, and Argyll and Bute have apologised to those affected by what was an error. My officials met with Argyll and Bute Health and Social Care Partnership and NHS Highland to ensure that this problem was rectified as soon as it was identified, and everyone affected will be contacted as soon as possible with a new appointment for the correct local vaccination clinic to follow. Obviously, errors like this in a large-scale programme, when they happen, are deeply regrettable, but that does not take away from the massive success of this vaccination programme, which is the only thing right now that is preventing all of us having to live with much greater restrictions, because it is helping protect against serious illness. On the wider questions on those with compromised or suppressed immune systems, of course, they are being offered additional boosters. That is the first line of protection, and I set out the broad timescale for that in my statement. We will also, after the population-wide testing programme ceases in its current form, testing will be used to ensure that those who would benefit from antiviral treatment, and that is still being offered on a fairly restricted basis, but will expand as more antiviral treatments become available. But testing will be continued to be used to ensure that those who would benefit and are eligible for antivirals get speedy access to that treatment. And we will continue to ensure that we communicate with those in particular groups about the ongoing provision of testing. Some of the detail of this, of course, has already been set out in the testing strategy published, I think, 2 weeks ago right now. And in terms of schools, we will continue to develop the school's guidance. It is not testing, of course, that is causing some young people to be absent. It's high levels of infection, and it's important that we get infection levels down so that we reduce the impact of the virus on schools, as we want to reduce it in broader society as well. So we continue, as we have done all along, to take a balanced approach to the measures that are in place in schools. We will continue to ensure targeted access to testing on the basis that's set out in the testing strategy. And of course, if necessary, we will go beyond that as far as we can, given the constraints on funding that I have set out previously in this chamber.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I too share Jackie Bailey's concerns about the paucity of detail around the removal of access to universal LFTs for free. A fortnight ago, I wrote to the First Minister regarding the cost of lateral flow tests after the 1st of May. Scottish Government has moved in lockstep with the UK Government on testing, and that means an end to free lateral flow tests in almost all circumstances. They are already selling online. Thousands of people rely on LFTs to protect their loved ones from COVID, to protect people who they know are immunosuppressed and who spent months shielding. They understandably want to give them comfort and confidence. These people will be worried about the new cost of caring. It's nothing short of a visit your grand tax. Will the First Minister guarantee that all carers, NHS staff, care home staff and visitors have access to free COVID tests? And will she commit to creating a scheme to ensure free LFTs are available for those anxious to protect vulnerable loved ones?
First Minister.
Well, the Scottish Government is not in the same position on testing as the UK Government, as any cursory look at the position of the UK Government in testing right now would testify to. We are still supporting testing in ways that is not currently the case in the UK. We will continue to support appropriate and targeted use of testing for the purposes set out in the testing strategy. And crucially, where we are advising people to take tests, we will not expect anyone to pay for those tests. We will continue to ensure access free of charge to testing. And of course, we will continue to have discussions with those who are caring for people, those visiting loved ones in particular settings, to make sure that there is appropriate access to testing as we move beyond the population-wide approach that we have taken for the period up until now.
Stephanie Callaghan to be followed by Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given the relentless pressures in NHS Lanarkshire acute care, with local hospitals currently operating beyond 100% capacity, can I ask the First Minister what more the Scottish Government can do to ensure the public is aware of the right place to access non-critical care services and that such provision is available?
First Minister.
Well, we continue to work with the health service in a range of ways to support them through what is an exceptionally challenging period. We're also taking steps to ensure that the public is aware of the right place to access non-critical care needs and what provision is available. A number of public awareness campaigns have been run, including the General Practice Access campaign, the Right Care, Right Place campaign, the NHS 24 winter campaign and the receptionist campaign, which aired in March on television and radio, focusing on the role of the receptionist as a navigator of care. So we will continue as part of the broader efforts to reform how people access care in a way that is better for them to ensure that this information is available while the NHS continues to navigate through this incredibly difficult period.
Sandesh Gulhani to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, I saw a woman in her 20s who subsequently died from ovarian cancer because she was too worried to present with her symptoms due to GPs being overwhelmed. We know that none of the health boards have met the 62-day standard for treating suspected cancer patients. And Macmillan Cancer have said that the cancer care system was struggling pre-pandemic and is now failing to cope despite the Herculean efforts of NHS staff. So my question is, what is the government doing now, and I stress now, to help save the lives of those who are facing delays for cancer treatment? As we know, early diagnosis and timely treatment lead to better outcomes. And the money you have already announced has not solved this problem.
First Minister.
Cancer care has continued rightly to be a priority throughout the pandemic, and it continues to be so. The 31-day cancer treatment target has been met consistently. The 62-day target, there is a real focus on ensuring that is met. Of course, median waiting times for access to treatment are very short. but we recognise the importance of doing more around early detection of cancer, which is why the Detect Cancer Early campaign has the investment and the support that it does. The new early diagnostic centres that I've spoken about previously in the Chamber are also being developed. So this is a really important area of care, and I would want to end this answer with a very strong message to anybody who has symptoms indicative of cancer or anybody who has symptoms causing a concern that they might have cancer to seek medical attention urgently and to contact their GP. Cancer is and will continue to be a clinical priority in the National Health Service.
John Mason to be followed by Paul O'Kane.
Thank you. I have to confess that the 2,300 people in hospital does concern me quite a lot and concerns quite a lot of other people. Is the First Minister confident that these numbers are going to reduce without us having further restrictions in place?
First Minister.
Well, the number in hospital is obviously a concern to me and to the Health Secretary, to the Government, which is why I think it is important that we continue to exercise a degree of caution. What we know from the journey of this infection, any infection, but what we also know from experience through COVID, is that as we start to see case numbers come down, as we are hopefully now beginning to see with this latest wave of infection, we will start to see the pressure on hospitals ease as well. And obviously we are keen to see that happen as quickly as possible. There is some early indication in the hospital admission figures that we're starting to see that slight easing of pressure, but we want to see that intensify in the days and weeks to come. It is the case, of course, that vaccination is providing significant protection against serious illness. The hospital numbers that we are seeing right now, although they are putting a severe pressure on the health service, would be much, much higher but for vaccination. And because of vaccination, the numbers needing intensive care are lower than they have been at previous stages of the pandemic. So I am not complacent. None of us should be complacent about the pressure on our National Health Service. But we know if we see case numbers fall, and if this wave has peaked, we will start to see that become more pronounced in the days ahead, then we will start to see some days after that the pressure on our NHS ease as well.
Paul O'Kane to be followed by Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Our hospitals are under immense pressure and any waiting times are shocking. Care at home and residential care services are also under immense pressure, and schools are having to temporarily close in some parts of the country. Staffing shortages, already high, are being exacerbated by COVID-related absences. And as a consequence, people who need support are often falling through the gaps, and staff are struggling to keep things going. These are older people who need care and young people who are preparing for exams. So what urgent additional support will the First Minister provide to support services in desperate need? And can she also clarify the Government's plans for self-isolation and testing as we move forward into the spring and summer period?
First Minister.
The Education Secretary has previously set out support for young people studying for exams. Of course, we continue to engage with COSLA in terms of support that local authorities are providing for social care services. The future approach to testing and self-isolation has been set out in the testing strategy. We will continue to advise people right now who test positive and after that who have symptoms of COVID to isolate. I think that is the responsible thing for all of us to do. One of the biggest challenges, even after vaccination, given the protection against serious illness, of case rates as high as they are right now, are the absences that are caused, staff absences that are caused across key and critical services. And the way to ease that is to get case numbers down, which is why we continue to take the cautious approach that we are, and why we are optimistic that we are starting to see that corner being turned so that that pressure, along with the other pressures in the NHS, will ease in the days ahead.
Audrey Nicholl to be followed by Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. People who are vaccinated are less likely to develop long COVID, even if they catch the virus. A rapid review by the UK Health Security Agency suggests. So would the First Minister therefore encourage anyone who hasn't yet had the vaccine to come forward and do so?
First Minister.
Yes, I would very strongly give that encouragement. The study referred to underlines the benefits of receiving a full course of COVID vaccination. It is the best way of protecting ourselves from serious symptoms when we get infected, and it might also help to reduce any longer-term impact. We know that vaccination has been the most effective tool that we've had against the virus, and that is going to continue to be the case. So if you haven't come forward for your first, second, third dose yet, it's not too late. Please make sure you contact the helpline or get in touch with your doctor in order to get the vaccination as quickly as possible. It is not too late to be vaccinated, so please don't feel embarrassed about coming forward now. You could be giving yourself and your loved ones vital protection.
Julie Mackay, to be followed by Christine Graham.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. For some, face coverings are an inconvenience. However, for some, they are the difference between going about their lives safely and contracting a serious illness. Face coverings reduce risk, and they provide an extra layer of protection to people who are vulnerable to the virus, many of whom will be concerned about the decision to convert the legal requirement into guidance. Has the Scottish Government consulted with disabled people's organisations about the impact this decision will have on people who are clinically vulnerable?
First Minister.
We'll continue to engage with a range of groups in the population about all of these decisions. It is the case, and I've laid this out in the Chamber many times before, that with any legal restriction, we have to be sure that we are acting lawfully, and that means we must make an assessment about the proportionality of keeping any measure in law, and that applies to the face covering measure as it did previously to all others. So these are decisions that we have to balance carefully. But Gillie Mackay is right, I think, in terms of the broad balance of public opinion around face coverings. I have to say, I get many more contacts from people worried about the requirement to wear a face covering no longer being in law than I get from people who are annoyed about having to wear face coverings. I accept that nobody wants to have to do anything like this if it's not necessary. But I think the vast majority of people recognise that wearing a face covering, if it helps provide some protection to others, particularly those who are most clinically vulnerable to this virus, then it's something, particularly after all of the sacrifice and the heartache of the past couple of years, then being asked to do that for a couple more weeks, I think is something the vast majority of people accept, whether or not they like it. So I think these decisions have to be taken carefully, and we will seek to do that as far as we possibly can.
Christine Graham, to be followed by Murdo Fraser.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Following much on the same strain, does the First Minister agree with me that Douglas Ross should remember that we wear face coverings not just for ourselves, but mainly to protect the stranger next to us on the bus, in the supermarket, who may be undergoing, for example, cancer treatment, is immune deficient, you don't know that, and they need us to wear our mask so they can at least go out and shop?
Before, First Minister, before you respond, can I just point out that the issues that members are encouraged to ask questions raised by the First Minister in her statement? Thank you. First Minister, very briefly, because we're very tight for time.
I think we should possibly all remember the sort of wall of abuse that's coming from that section of the chamber. We might have disagreements here, but we're dealing with a pandemic of an infectious virus, and perhaps we could try to deal with these issues in a more civilised way than some right now are demonstrating in this chamber. Christine Graham is right. The wearing of a face covering is about giving other people protection. And when you're in a supermarket, you don't know who might be close by who is more clinically vulnerable to this virus. And while infection levels are as high as they are right now, and we hope they will reduce in the days and weeks to come, but while they're as high as they are right now, if wearing a face covering in a supermarket, for example, might be reducing the risk of passing the virus to somebody who, if they did get it, would become or be at risk of becoming seriously unwell, then I think that's a price most of us are willing to pay at this stage of the pandemic.
Call Murdo Fraser, to be followed by Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given everything the First Minister has just said, why wasn't she wearing a face mask yesterday?
Yeah. First Minister.
I abided by the rules in place there. I wore a face covering on the train to London and the train back from London. I abide by the rules, and I know that's something that perhaps the Conservatives struggle to understand, but I abide by the rules.
And Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. With news reports suggesting the Met Police is about to issue fines.
I'd be very grateful if we could hear Ms. Mackay. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. With news reports suggesting the Met Police is about to issue fines to at least 20 officials who breached COVID restrictions by attending parties held at Downing Street, is the First Minister concerned that these events in Westminster potentially undermine public health messaging here in Scotland?
Again, First Minister, I appreciate that the issue touches on COVID. It may be the view of the member that that is the case. However, these are questions to do with issues raised in the First Minister's statement. First Minister, very briefly.
I do believe that it is important to continue to take balanced judgments. I hope we're getting to a point where all of this is behind us. But right now, while levels of infection are as high, my job, my duty, is to take decisions that are right for the people of Scotland. That's what I'm going to continue to do. No doubt that will meet a wall of criticism, whatever I do, from the Conservative benches. But my job, my duty, is to do right by the people of Scotland, and that's what I'll always seek to do.
Thank you. That concludes the First Minister's statement on COVID-19 update. There'll be a brief pause before the next item.